welcome to module 2 of our little series about playing golf croquet. In this module we're going to be looking at the turn and things that can happen during the turn. So let's say first, what is a turn? Well, a turn is the period of time for a single shot in golf croquet from the time when the striker actually moves into position to strike the ball to the time when the balls stop moving or leave the court. Now, there is a subset of that, so if the turn is this long, if you like, there is a subset of that which is about that long, which is known as the striking period, when the striker actually takes up stance to hit the ball, hits the ball, and then moves away under control. And moving away under control is important, because if you then hit the ball and fall over, that's hardly under control, and you may well create a fault in so doing. But we'll look at that in a moment. The croquet court is actually quite a large area. It's 28 yards wide and 35 yards long. So that's quite a bit of space. And as you can see, that the two chaps currently playing are rather lost in the enormity of it all. But the court is marked out by a white boundary line. We'll have a look at that in a bit more detail. A croquet court is delineated by a white boundary line. Here we are. This is the court. This is the outside of the court. But which is the boundary? Is it here? Is it here? Or is it here? Well, the boundary is actually the inside of the white line. So imagine a vertical wall from the inside of the white line. And if any part of the ball is over that white line, such as that, it is out, it is off the court, and it becomes what is called in the rules an external agent. So to all intents and purposes, once a ball has left the court like that, it no longer exists. It's taken off the court and put back on the court if necessary, or when it has gone off, in the place where it went off, so that other people can see where the ball should lie. But you can't actually use that ball until it's played into the game in the next turn for, in this case, the red ball. When the ball is played back into the game, part of the ball must be touching the boundary. So part of the ball must be slightly either on or over the white line. At the beginning of a game, the two players, and in this case it's going to be Ray and Lynn, start the game in corner four. And as you may notice, in corner four there is a yellow flag. The other corners can have flags as well. They're less important in golf croquet than in association croquet, because in golf either the ball's in or out, it's fairly academic in a way. But we start in corner four, and the two players, or the two sides, toss a coin to decide who's going to start. So Ray's going to toss, he's the lower handicapper, and Lynn, who is the higher handicapper, is going to shout. And that's the custom. The lower handicapper tosses, the higher handicapper calls heads or tails. Off you go, Ray.
What would you like? Heads or tails?
Tails, please.
Tails it is.
So, tails it is. Now, what did you call Lynn?
Tails.
Tails. Lynn called correctly, and in this game, if you win the toss, you must start. There is no option. So Lynn will start with the blue ball, and she will also have the black ball. Ray will then follow on with the red and yellow balls. So here we are in corner four, and the game starts by putting a ball anywhere in a quadrant of a yard from the corner point, and I'm going to take this flag out. You can take the flag out if it gets in your way. So a yard and a quadrant like that. Indeed, some clubs have them a quadrant marked out. We don't here because we don't want to upset our bowling friends. So the first ball can go anywhere in that quadrant, and Lynn is now going to play it over towards hoop one. So here we are at hoop one, and I put a piece of string out to show you what I call the triangle of success. If coming across from corner four, you can manage to get a ball roughly into this triangle, as this blue ball is here, you've got a pretty good chance of running hoop one. And I call, as you can see, I put some bisque sticks out here, about 3.5 feet from the hoop, and I call this the quadrilateral of power, because if your ball lands in here in particular, it's going to be very difficult for an opponent who is quite a long way away over there to knock it out, and B, you've again got a very good chance of making the hoop. One of the common errors that people make is to think that if they can put their ball very close to the hoop, they've got a good chance of running it. Well, yes, they have, but corner four is 21 yards away. Here is a ball with a stripe on it, and if we go roughly just over a foot, 18 inches out from the hoop, how many rolls will it take for the ball to get into this little triangle here? So there's one and a half rolls from 21 yards. That's a big ask, and don't really try and do it. If you come out to here, you've got a lot more room for error. So there's one roll, two rolls, three rolls, four rolls, four and a half rolls. So that's a lot more room for error than trying to put your ball close to the hoop. So Lynn's first ball, the blue ball, has very fortunately landed up in my quadrilateral of power, very nicely placed indeed. What are Red's options here? Well, first of all, there's absolutely no point in Red coming along and sitting here, because you've got to assume that a reasonable player is actually going to make that hoop. So Red really needs to have a go at hitting this ball out of the way. I'm not sure if he can do it or not, we'll soon see. Well, it was a near miss, a gallant effort, but Red has ended up about 5 yards away from the blue. Now, of course, Lynn will be playing her black and Ray his yellow, so we'll let them get on with that. As you can see, Ray's last shot was nearly very good. He just touched the blue, but not with any power enough to move it any distance. And the yellow ball has now ended up just behind the blue ball, but also blocking a possible shot from Red. Well, of course, the blue ball will play first, but blue should be able to run the hoop. So we'll now ask Lynn to come and demonstrate. So that was a nice hoop for Lynn, and the game now progresses with Ray playing the next shot with his red ball, and he would go down towards hoop two. Now, the little sequence you've just seen demonstrates a couple of things. First of all, the importance of getting your first blue ball into this quadrilateral of power, which virtually guarantees you a hoop under most circumstances. Secondly, if you're going to play to knock the blue ball out, you've got to go hard at it. There's no point in playing a gentle shot because you're not going to move it very far. You've got to go hard and take the chance that you are in fact going to move the ball. Now, top quality players wouldn't actually put their balls there because they are confident of running the hoop from much greater distances than we lowly people. And a good player, a top quality player, would probably put their blue ball, their first ball, out here. And the logic behind that is that if it gets hit away, it's going to probably end up on a boundary, but it won't end up on that boundary, it will end up on this boundary, so you've still got a sight of the hoop. But don't try and do that unless you're confident about being able to run a hoop from 5 yards, which is not altogether easy for most people. In the last sequence, we looked at Blue being in a good position to run hoop one. This time, Blue has rather overrun the triangle of success, and it's come into a position where you really can't run the hoop from there. But Lynn is going to play it and see what happens next. So Lynn has played the blue ball into a very nice position, straight in front of the hoop. Of course, it's now Red's turn to play, and Ray is going to show us what can happen in this situation. The red ball has removed the blue and put blue in a safe place. And that amounts to one of Ian's basic rules of golf croquet. If you have an opponent ball in a hoop running position, get rid of it, because you never quite know what's going to happen next. If you've got a chance to get rid of a hoop running opponent ball and you can't really run the hoop yourself easily, get rid of that opponent ball. Now, of course, it will be Black's turn to play. And Black has ended up here, again, quite nicely from the hoop. I'm going to put Lynn under more pressure and see what she can do with her black ball. And Lynn missed. No great shame in that. What that means is that yellow ball, which is out here, now has a pretty good shot at the hoop as well. And Ray can afford to take that hoop shot, because Lynn's blue ball is also at a quite difficult angle. So even if yellow misses, he's not giving away too much to the opposition. And so he missed as well. But the game carries on now in this sequence of blue, red, black, yellow, until one of the players manages to run the hoop, and then we all move down to hoop two.
So how do we know when a hoop is run and scored? Here we are at hoop one, so the ball needs to run the hoop in that direction. Here is the ball approaching the hoop, and when it gets to that position, so that it's broken the plane on the playing side of the hoop, but not on the dead side of the hoop, it's said to be in the jaws of the hoop. But as soon as the ball breaks the plane on the non-playing side, this side, it's said to be running the hoop. And it can be running the hoop until it's nearly all the way through. That's still running the hoop. And it's run the hoop when the ball clears the plane on the playing side. So that ball has now run the hoop. Now, if a ball comes the wrong way through the hoop, still hoop one, and it must go through in that direction, it's quite legitimate for the ball to come back into the hoop from the non-playing side, but it has to clear the plane on the non-playing side, in other words, put itself back into the jaws, before it can move back again in the next turn. And if, perchance, for example, and it does happen that there is a rabbit run in the hoop where the ground is worn, the ball might come back through and then settle there, unless it has stood still for at least 5 seconds on the playing side of the hoop before it rolls back again, it would not count as having stood still on the playing side of the hoop. So it would still be in a position where it had yet to clear the plane on the non-playing side.
In golf croquet, there are really a very limited number of shots that you need to play. They are concerned with either hitting a ball away, to get rid of that blue ball for example, or putting a ball in a very accurately placed position in front of the hoop, or of course running a hoop. And in every case, you do not start by, if I'm going to play the red ball, for example, you do not do this. I see this so often. people walk up to a ball, stand over it and hit it. That is a good way of missing a ball. You need to start back here, what, about 3 or even 4 yards back from the ball you're going to hit. And the whole point of this, it's lining yourself up so that your feet, the mallet and the two balls, my ball, the striker's ball and the target ball, are all in a straight line. And to hit one away with the other, I simply swing the mallet through the ball. Very simple, no great difficulty that, but it does take a bit of practice. And practice in all forms of sport, it requires effort, time, and croquet is no different. You've got to be prepared to come and practice on your own, do simple things like that, until you can do them without thinking about them. So hitting a ball away was one example of how we play a shot. The other one which I mentioned, was putting a ball in a position so that it can run a hoop. And again, as before, it's absolutely essential that you line up. The official name is stalking the ball. I think it's a terrible term, but that's what it's called. And people think it's an affectation. It really isn't. It's vital, absolutely vital, because it's all about getting your feet into the right place. And in order to do that, you stalk the ball, you line it up, you look at the ball, only at the ball, and keep your head down until the ball has virtually reached where it's going to go. And from there, I'd be reasonably comfortable about running that hoop. And the final type of shot is running the hoop. Running the hoop is exactly the same as the other two shots. You have to stalk the ball. You swing the mallet gently. And as you hit the ball, follow through. So the mallet seems to go almost through the hoop. When you're trying to run a hoop, swing the mallet and follow through so that what you're doing is putting some top spin on the ball, which will help the ball to spin through the hoop if you hit one of the wires. If you jab at the ball, if it hits one of the wires, the chances are that it will not run through the hoop. So let's just have a look at running angled hoops. We don't normally have pieces of string on the lawn. In fact, any aid whatsoever is illegal. But this is just to give you an idea of how it can work. Here we have the red ball at an angle to this particular hoop. And I want to get it through the hoop. And basically, I need to make sure that as it's approaching the hoop, the red ball just misses this near upright. They're called wires because in the olden days when hoops were like that, they were literally made out of bits of wire. Nowadays, they're very solid pieces of steel. So the ball needs to just miss this near wire and then it will go through the hoop. If it hits the near wire, it will bounce off like that. If it hits this wire, the farther wire, as long as the centre of the ball is more or less in the hoop, it will bounce through. Just have a look at that. This, on the first shot, I'm going to deliberately hit the near wire. And you can see the ball is just on the string now. This time I'm going to hit the further wire and it will bounce through. In order to help your hoop running skills, there are several little exercises you can do, and I put some of them on the Basingstoke website under the heading of golf croquet practice routines. It's just a little set of text routines that you can download and have a go on. Here's a very easy one, and you simply put the ball just in front of the hoop, tap it through, walk round,
track it back again from wherever it stops. And you can carry on doing this for as long as you like. It's good practice
and it just builds up your confidence.
As you can see, that ball didn't actually run the hoop, but in golf croquet, getting the ball into the hoop can be nearly as powerful as actually running it, and in some cases more so, because if you get the ball into the hoop on one of the long hoop runs, for example between hoop 1 and hoop 2, or between hoop 3 and hoop 4, when you come to play the ball in your next turn, you have the possibility of scoring two hoops in the one shot. Slightly fortuitous, but that's the nature of golf croquet.
A similar exercise called round the clock is where you put the balls in a sort of semicircle around the hoop, and again just have a go at running the hoop. Don't make it too difficult. So on, and very good practice. It just builds up your confidence so that when you come to have to run hoops for real, you don't get panic stricken.
One of the skills of golf croquet is being able to hit balls away and balls that are at quite different distances. When balls are close together, such as this blue and red, it's very easy because you have a choice of two sorts of shot basically. You can either do a stop shot where the blue ball will stop shortly after hitting the red, or a drive where the blue will carry on considerably further. We'll do a drive shot first, and in a drive shot, by and large, the striker's ball, in this case the blue ball, will go roughly one third of the distance of the ball that is the object ball. So I'm going to hit this straight across the lawn. So there you can see the relative distances that these two balls have gone. And you need to be confident and secure in your own mind about the relative distances that balls are going to travel when you play that sort of shot. Let's try it again, but this time with a stop shot. So here we are back in the same place, and this time I'm going to play a stop shot, which basically means stopping the mallet as soon as it hits the blue ball. And you can, if you wish, ground the back of the mallet into the lawn, although that's not really necessary once you've got the knack of doing it. This time the blue ball has stayed in the vicinity here. The red ball has gone nearly right across to the other side of the lawn. I'm going to do the same shot now with two other balls a little bit further apart. First of all a drive and then a stop shot. And the stop shot becomes less effective the further apart the two balls are. So this is the drive shot first, on the black hitting the yellow away. The yellow ball has gone a long way across the lawn, and my black has stayed fairly close. I'll try that again with a stop shot. I'm going to play exactly the same shot, but this time with a stop shot action. And I think you'll see that the black ball will go much the same sort of distance as on the drive shot. It's very much more difficult to make it stop quickly at this range. Here we are again, the yellow's across the other side of the lawn. The black has travelled, what, about 5 or 6 yards. So why do stop shots work? Well, here is the ball we're going to play, and I'm going to use this ball with the stripe as my striker's ball. What happens is that when this ball is struck hard, it skids along the ground and then hits the object ball almost without spinning. And it's that fact that the ball is not spinning that transfers the energy in this ball into the object ball. And so this ball will shoot off at some speed. And I'm going to try and do that for you now so you can see, hopefully, that this ball does not spin very much. I realise that that was a little bit quick, but I hope you managed to see that the striped ball really wasn't doing very much spinning. It went straight into the red ball and actually knocked it all the way across the other side of the lawn. When the balls are further apart, as they are here, this ball, when you strike it, will start to skid, and then the milling on the ball will start to take over and force the ball to spin. And as soon as it starts spinning, its energy is transferred less effectively, because some of the energy is being used to make this ball spin. So it will not make the object ball go quite as far, but of course, because this is already spinning, this ball itself will go further, so it won't be a stop shot. So I'll put them further apart and you can see the difference. So as you can see, even though I played a stop shot action, the striker's ball has come about 6 yards and the object ball has gone nearly across the lawn.
So here we are in front of hoop one. I'm playing the red ball. My blue opponent has landed here. I've come a little bit further, and in order to stop him getting into a position to run the hoop, I'm going to smack him quite hard across the lawn. And my red ball will go nothing like as far as the blue ball. This is a simple drive shot. Stalking the ball again. And as you can see, my red ball has stopped quite nicely in front of the hoop. I could probably run that hoop in my next turn. The blue ball has gone quite a long way across the lawn. If I were closer to the hoop than that, I would do a stop shot. So this is basically the same scenario, but the blue ball is now in a very powerful position. He or she could run that hoop with no bother whatsoever. So I want to put myself in roughly the same position as the blue, and if I did a drive shot that I've just shown you, my red ball would end up quite a long way away. So a stop shot is literally that. It's stopping the mallet at the instant that it hits the red ball. And you can do that either just as a matter of timing, or some people do it by grounding the mallet, the heel of the mallet, there, onto the ground at the instant that that the red ball is hit. It doesn't really make any difference. You've just got to practice it until you're comfortable doing it for yourself. So it works like this. Little stalk there. That's gone a little bit further than I would have liked, but that's still not bad.
So that little